Today's topic is matrix chain multiplication using dynamic programming. Let's say we are given two matrices A and B of dimensions m cross n and n cross p respectively. Then you might know that the resultant matrix will have the dimension m cross p. Now we want to find out what is the number of multiplications required to obtain the resultant matrix C. Let us observe a few things. First of all, the resultant matrix has m into p elements, so that the number of multiplications is at least m into p. Now, let's think about how each element of the resultant matrix is calculated. We take the corresponding row from the first matrix and the corresponding column from the second matrix. Each of them has the dimension n, and we multiply the corresponding elements and take their sum. So we go through n elements. So to calculate each element of the resultant matrix, we do n operations. So overall, the cost of multiplying two matrices of dimension m cross n and n cross p is m into n into p. M and p multiplications are required for two matrices. Now, a matrix chain is simply multiple matrices one after the other. We will assume that the multiplication is possible and the dimensions are correct. Now, what will be the total number of multiplications to multiply the whole chain of matrices? Since matrix multiplication is associative, we can select any two adjacent matrices and multiply them. So, will the answer depend on the order in which we choose the matrices? Well, yes. Let's take a simple example of a chain of three matrices. So, in the first case, if we multiply the first two, the number of multiplications will be 1 into 100 into 1. And then we multiply the third matrix with the product of the first two. So in that case, number of multiplications will be 1 into 1 into 100, because the resultant matrix of the first two will have dimension 1 into 1. So total number of multiplications are 200. While on the other hand, in the second case, if we first multiply the last two matrices and then multiply the first with their product, the total number of multiplications will be 2000. So clearly there is a factor of 10 involved. So clearly, using this example, you can see that though the answer matrix of a matrix chain is the same, the number of multiplications required to obtain the resultant matrix depends on the order in which you choose your matrices. So, let's say we have a chain of 6 matrices represented by letters A through F, and we decide to multiply them in some random order. So B into C is, let's say, W, E into F is X, D into X is Y, A into W is Z, and Z into Y is M. The matrix M is our answer. In optimization problems, it often helps to think whether there exists a greedy strategy rather than directly jumping to dynamic programming. Let's take a look at the following greedy strategy, which says, in the matrix chain, at each step, find the pair of adjacent matrices with the least product of M and P. I would encourage you to pause the video and apply this strategy on this example. Since the first two have the least product of M and P, multiply both of them first and multiply their product with the third matrix. Compare that with the answer you get by first multiplying the last two matrices and then their product with the first. you will find that using the greedy strategy, you get an answer of 24, while using the other method, you get an answer of 20, which is lesser. So clearly, the greedy strategy is incorrect. So we need to look for an alternative dynamic programming based solution. In some DP problems, it often helps to think backwards. In the last step, we multiplied Z and Y to get M. But what was Z? It was A into W and Y was D into X. W itself was B into C and X itself was E into F. So, if you observe carefully, in the last step, we multiplied a prefix of the chain with a suffix of the chain. Or in other words, we made two partitions of the matrix chain. Now, let's think about it generally. If we have a matrix chain of n matrices from M1 to Mn of dimensions R1, C1, R2, C2 up to Rn, Cn, then in the last step, we would have combined some prefix of the chain from M1 to Mk and a suffix of the chain from Mk plus 1 to Mn. What would be the cost of this combining step? Our first matrix, which was Z in the last slide, will have a dimension of R1 by Ck, and the other matrix, which was Y in the last slide, will have a dimension of Rk plus 1 by Cn. Of course, Ck will be equal to Rk plus 1. That was the combining cost. But what about the cost to obtain the matrix Z itself? That is the prefix M1 to Mk. Well, that is a subproblem. This is similar to our original problem, only that instead of N, we have K. Similarly, the suffix, the cost of obtaining the suffix is also a subproblem. So overall, the number of multiplications required to obtain M can be written as the number of multiplications required to obtain the prefix plus number of multiplications required to obtain the suffix and their combining cost, which is R1 into Ck into Cn. So let's define the recurrence relation for our DP. We define cost ij as the minimum cost, or in other words, the number of multiplications, it's one and the same thing. Minimum cost to compute the matrix product from mi to mj, that is only a segment of the matrix chain. Finally, as our answer, we want cost of 1, n. So our recurrence is cost of ij is the minimum over all k from I to j exclusive, cost of the prefix plus cost of the suffix plus combining cost. And when there is only one matrix, the cost would be 0. That is our base case. In words, the recurrence relation is just checking all values of k in the segment I to j, from k is equal to I to j exclusive, and taking minimum over all of those. Now, we will approach the problem by writing a recursive function. So, if you want to try on your own, feel free to pause and think about it. So, this is our function for calculating the minimum cost. It takes as input the dimensions of the matrix, which is a pair of integers, so pii is just a pair of integers, and inj, that is the subsegment over which we want to calculate the cost. I have just converted the relations in mathematical form into code. So if I is equal to j, there is only one matrix, return 0. Otherwise, from k is equal to I to j, check for all values of k, calculate the recurrence relation and take minimum over all k. Finally, return the minimum cost. So from the main function, we'll call recur matrix chain 0 to n minus 1 if the vector is 0 indexed. But if you draw the recursion tree for the function calls, you will find out that there are a lot of repeated function calls. So like in this tree, the call 00 is repeated twice, 11 is repeated twice, 22 is repeated twice. So there are a lot of repeated subproblems. If you draw a tree for even bigger matrix chain, here the size of the matrix chain is just 3, 0 to 2. If you do it for a bigger matrix chain, you will find that there are even more repeated subproblems. So let's see an iterative or bottom-up version of the DP solution. We take a DP array of size n cross n and fill it with infinity, since finally we want to calculate the minimum cost. So initially the answer for all cells should be infinity, and then when we take minimum, it will get the actual final value in that cell. So DP of ij will store the minimum number of multiplications for the segment of matrix chain I to j, both inclusive. And as a return value of the function, we will return dp0 to n minus 1, that is cost for the whole chain. Now the main question is, in what order do we have to iterate in order to fill the dp table? If you observe the recurrence relation carefully, it says that cost ij depends on cost ik and cost k plus 1j for all k between I and j. Cost ik will be to the left of cost ij since k is less than j, and cost k plus 1j will be below cost ij since k is greater than equal to I. So to fill cell ij, we must have first filled cells to the left of it and cells which are below it. And hence, we need to fill the table from bottom to top, left to right, or if you are aware of the term, in the topological order. So this part of the code does that. We are iterating I from n minus 1 to 0, bottom to top, and j from I to n, that is left to right. Note that we need to start j from I, because if j is less than I, it won't be a valid segment. So if I is equal to j, dp of ij is 0. And we iterate k from I to j and take minimum over all k of dp ij. And we will return dp of 0 n minus 1. So this was the iterative version of the DP solution. Important to note was that we fill the table from bottom to top and left to right, because that is how all dependencies are resolved. Finally, if you want, here is a full running example of a matrix chain of 5 matrices. On the left is the code from the last slide, and on the right is our DP table. Just watch and try to observe how the table is filled. When I is equal to j, we simply fill 0 as there is no dependency to the left or bottom, and it is the base case. To calculate answer for any cell, we have to check all the cells to the left of it and below it in some particular pairing and take minimum over all those pairings added with, of course, R1, CK and CJ. The minimum value over all these k's fills that cell ij. So finally, dp of 0, 4 is our answer. What about upper bound of the time complexity of this approach? Outer loop variable is going from n minus 1 to 0, inner loop from I to n, so that is at least n square. And what do we do for each iteration of the inner loop? So k goes from I to j, so in the worst case we'll have to check all n minus 1 entries to the left of the cell, like in the top right cell. We'll have to check all the entries to the left and to the bottom, so that is n minus 1 entries. So overall the time complexity is big O of n cubed.